For this lecture, we are going to see the working of the slip ring induction motor. In the previous lecture, we have seen about the working principle of the three-phase induction motor. So, as per the Faraday's second law, that means Faraday's second law states that when the current carrying conductor kept in magnetic field, it experiences a force. And these rules, this Faraday's second law, we are applying for the induction motor. Now, for this lecture, we are going to see the working of the slip ring induction motor. Before that, I will show just one photograph, that one image of that particular slip ring as well as the squirrel cage induction motors. As we know that the for squirrel cage induction motor, there is no any windings in the rotor winding. But here, for the slip ring induction motors, it is also known as a wound rotor, wound type rotor or simply wound rotors. So, this is nothing but there is a different windings we are provided in the induction motor of rotor, that is slip ring induction motors. So compared to slip ring squirrel cage induction motor, the slip ring induction motor has a winding in the rotor side. Now all these windings are brought together into the slip rings, and again by using this slip ring and brush arrangement, we can control the speed of the slip ring induction motors. Now for this PPD, we are going to see for this lecture, we are going to see the working of the slip ring induction motor. Again, this is one of the image of the slip ring induction motor where I can show this. Now this is the different slots. You can see this particularly, this is nothing but a rotor structures. So again, in the different rotor slot, I am putting this winding of the rotors. Now again, there are different three phase windings are provided in the rotor slot as well as the stator slot. As we know that stator slots, it has a three phase windings. Again, for this, especially for slip ring induction motor, we are providing the rotor winding in the rotor slots. Here now all these rotor windings I'm connected to this particular three slip rings. Now for this particular type, we are using the slip rings, that means this one I'm showing in by using the cursors. These are the slip rings, all these parts which are connected throughout the shaft. Now these are the slip rings. Now because of using slip rings, this type of motor is called as a slip ring induction motors. In the rotor, they have used the slip rings, then it is called as a slip ring induction motors. And as I stated earlier, this particular slip ring induction motor has the rotor winding. Now again, similar to that of stator winding, this rotor also having a three phases. Now you can see here, this is a one ring, this is one slip ring, this is second ring, this is third ring, this is a one, this is first, this is second, this is third. Again, the black color, this is nothing but a brush arrangement. This one, this is nothing but a brush arrangement. Now what will happen here, this end, one end of this particularly rotor winding I am connected to this. So simple is called as a, this is one ring is for R phase, second middle ring is for Y phase, or this end ring, this is outer ring is for B phase. That means these three rings are used for the slip ring induction motors. Now we will see one animated videos regarding the working of slip ring induction motor. In that videos, you can easily find out, you can easily understand how the induction motor, how this particular slip ring induction motor will work. So for this lecture, we are going to see the animated videos of the particularly slip ring induction motors. Now you can see here, this is slip ring induction motor. Now again, this is nothing but a rotor winding. We are inserting this rotor winding in the different rotor slot. We can show here. Now this particularly, this is nothing but a rotor slots in which we are placing, or simply called, we are housing the rotor conductors. And all these rotor conductors were brought together in the different slip rings. These are nothing but slip rings. And by using the brush arrangement, this is nothing but a brush arrangement. Now we have the brush arrangement for this. Now we are connecting the brush arrangement with the slip rings. Now for this rotor, we have the slip ring. So this particular motor is nothing but is known as a slip ring induction motors. Now we will see the different videos regarding slip ring induction motors. Now this is a slip ring induction motor. We are comparing with a squirrel cage induction motor. Now you can see the difference. Now for squirrel cage rotor, there is no any winding, but it has only the rotor bars. You can show here. Now, but this is nothing but the rotor bars, and all these rotor bars we have connected by using these is nothing but end rings here and here. That is end ring here, one end is here, second end is here. Now, all this for the squirrel cage motor, this is nothing but a rotor bars. These rotor bars, I called aluminium bars or rotor bars, is act as the conductor in the squirrel cage rotor. While in the slip ring induction motor, we are using the winding. Now, winding, you know, winding is nothing but is rotor conductors or simply called the rotors. So, rotor winding. So, this is rotor winding is acts as a conductor in the slip ring induction motor. While this bar, we call the squirrel cage rotor bars, is used as a conductor in the rotor winding. Now you can see the working of this particular both the windings, squirrel cage rotor as well as the slip ring induction motors. Now this is nothing but the working principle. Now suppose we are considering the squirrel cage rotors. Now you can see this. Now this particular flux, the direction, we can show this N pole and this S pole. These two fluxes are created by the rotating, by the stator winding. We call the rotating magnetic field. Now these two here, these outer fluxes are generated by using the rotating magnetic field, which is created by the stator winding. Now again, these stator fluxes, I call the rotating magnetic fluxes, are interlinked, are going to interact with this particular aluminium bar. Here you can see here, this is nothing but aluminium bar, we call the rotor conductors. Now this particularly rotor conductors here, they are interlinked with the RMF, that is called as the rotating magnetic field. Now here, once they are making interaction, and now it will start to rotate. You can see this, the rotor, because of the interaction between the rotor, this is the rotor conductor and the stator flux, there is a rotating magnetic field. Now this rotor will start rotating because the rotating magnetic field will create interaction. As we know that the Faraday's second law, it states that whenever the current carrying conductor kept in the magnetic field, it experiences a mechanical force. Now this is nothing but this is a totally a magnetic field. This is a stator field. We call it a rotating magnetic field, simply called as a magnetic field. Now here, this due to the magnetic field, now the current is induced in the rotor conductor according to Faraday's first law. What is first law? Whenever the conductor cuts the flux, EMF is induced, and accordingly the current is there. So firstly, this rotor conductor induces this rotor conductor, this rotor conductor interact with the stator flux, we call the rotating magnetic flux, and hence according to Faraday's first law, the EMF is induced in that particular conductors. And once the EMF is induced, the circuit is completed through the end rings. Hence, because of this EMF, the current will circulate through the rotor bars. And again, once the current is circulated in the rotor conductor, now just apply the second law. Whenever the current carrying conductor kept in field, it experiences a mechanical force. Hence, now current carrying conductor is nothing but the rotor bars. Again, the flux is nothing but the rotating magnetic field. Right? You can see this. Now my rotor is start rotating. But for the as compared to the slip ring induction motor, the squirrel cage rotor has a very low starting torque. Now this will start rotating. Now we are going to focus on the slip ring induction motors. Now again, I shows one image of that particular slip ring induction motor. This is nothing but a rotor slot in which I am putting the rotor conductors, and I'm all these rotor windings, simple called as R phase winding, Y phase winding and V phase winding, I'm connected to the particular these three slip rings by using the brush arrangement. These are the black color, this one, these and this, this is nothing but a rotor, this is nothing but a brushes. Now all these having a slip rings. Now you can see the working of this particular slip induction motors. Now due to the conducting part in the rotor, this particular slippery induction motor has high starting torque compared to the squirrel cage induction motors. Now can you can see this, all these rotor conductors we are connected to this particular structure. Now it is one of the structure we call a squirrel cage induction motor. We can see this, this is when the current is input is given through the stator winding. Now this is nothing but a cable. We have, this is terminal box, we have connected all these parts, this stator winding to the state, this particularly terminal box. Now when we are giving supply to the stator winding, now rotating magnetic flux will be produced, and again due to this the rotor current is induced according to Faraday's first law. So again due to the rotor current, now what will happens, now the force is, now you can see this, the direction of the rotor current, this is nothing but the N and S pole, which is created by the stator, we call the rotating magnetic field. Now as we know that the fluxes are always passes from N pole to S pole, we can show the, we can see the directions here. Now the fluxes are passing from N to S here, again N to S. Now, this rotating magnetic field creates the current in the particularly this rotor conductors. Now, this rotor conductor means in the squirrel cage there is no any winding, but we have only the rotor bars. So, in the rotor bars, there is the current will induce because of the rotating magnetic field. You can see this. Now, this is nothing but the N pole and S pole. Now we can see this. There is a movement of the rotor. Now you can see the direction of the current. Now here, this blue color indicates the direction of the rotor current in the rotor. That is a squirrel cage rotor. Now because of this current, the force is exerted. You can see the force in the different directions. Now this means, suppose I consider this one, the force direction of these directions. Now suppose I consider these conductors, the force is this direction. Suppose I consider this one, now force is this direction. Now I consider this conductor, now force is this direction. That means for every conductor, we call the every rotor bar act as a conductor. For every conductor, the different parts of forces are exerted, the different part of forces are created, different parts of forces are produced. Now all these forces having the same unilateral direction, that means the same directions for every conductor. Now because of all this, you can see this. Now each conductor of the rotor having the different forces act on the particular conductors. Now all these fluxes or these forces creates the motion on the conductor, and hence this particularly conductors are moving. That means all these conductors are connected to rotor, and hence my rotor has start to flow. That is, rotor has start to rotate in a particular direction. Now you can see this particular current directions in this particular videos. Now again, I can show this one images. Now here the squirrel cage rotors, again this is nothing but a rotor bars. The currents are there, the fluxes are there, and connect this here N pole to S pole. This is nothing but an under the this N pole, and this is in the backward side S pole. So this area is nothing but a maximum flux area, because maximum flux are created, maximum flux are going to interlink with the rotor conductors. So this is nothing but a maximum flux area. Here the maximum torque is created as per here as well as the bottom side, the top upper side as well as the bottom side. Now here you can see the force direction of the force. Now here the maximum torque conditions. Now how the maximum torque conditions are there? Because here it is under the influence of the maximum flux which is created by the N pole and S pole. So at that particular conductor, the maximum torque is generated. Here, because of the, if the fluxes are more, obviously EMF are more, and if the EMF is maximum, obviously currents are maximum here in that particular section. Here now particular maximum currents are there because flux influences. And then you can see the different working of this particular squirrel cage rotors. Now we are moving towards the slip ring induction motors. Now here this is part of the stator winding. These all these parts having a stator winding. Now but here this is nothing but a rotor. In the stator and rotor, you can see this is nothing but a stator conductor, this is nothing but a rotor conductor. The gap between the stator and rotor is having the only of 1 millimeter or 0.5 millimeters. The gap is too much less. We call this is gap is nothing but an air gap. Air gap, it is a gap in between stator and rotor. स्टेटर आणि रोटर मधला जो काही गॅप आहे आपण त्याला एअर गॅप म्हणतोय. हा एअर गॅप इज ऑलवेज इट इज नथिंग बट अबाउट 0.5 mm टू 1 mm. नाउ दिस इज कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ द स्लिप रिंग इंडक्शन मोटर. यू कॅन सी दिस. नाउ दिस रोटर इज रोटेटिंग इन द स्टेटर वाइंडिंग. Now as I stated earlier, this is nothing but a rotor slots, and in which I am putting the different rotor conductors. I have the three phase windings, so I am connecting the different or different phase windings in the rotor bars, and now all these are connected to this particularly in the, so for simplicity I am showing all these. I'm suppose I'm removing, you can see this is nothing but a rotor bars, and in the rotor bars I am putting the rotor conductors. Now again, here I am putting all these rotor bars For simplicity, I call there the totally 24 slots windings are there. So totally, I suppose I divide it by 3 because I have 3 phases. So for R phase, there are totally 8 slots. Now you can see this 24 slots winding. Now for R phase, there are totally 8 slots are there. For Y phase, 8 slots, and for B phase, the remaining 8 slots are there. Now, once this particular conducting now. I consider that the totally 12 now here, this one, R, this is R phase, this is Y phase, and this is B phase. Now equally I am putting, now for this simplicity I call this the totally 12 slots are there. 12 slots means how much? So this is 1, 2, 12 divided by 3 because we have 3 phases, 12 divided by 4, it's a 4. So this is 4, this is 4 for R phase, 4 for Y phase, 4 slots for B phase. Now you can see this, now 1, 2, 3, 4, these two. And these two, these four slots are for R phase. Now you can see this. This is 1, 2. This is 2 slots, and this is 2. This 2 and 2 plus 4. So 4 slots for Y phase. Again, similarly, these 2 and these 2, 4 slots for B phase. Now, whatever the number of the slots in the rotor winding, accordingly we are equally distributed rotor conductors. You can see this. Now I have connected all these things into the slip rings. Now we can see the ideal case when the rotor is going to interlink with the stator conductors, now stator fluxes. Now here for each phase, the current directions here, currents are induced, and accordingly the forces are exerted on the rotor conductors. Now we already seen that all these rotor conductors we have connected to the slip rings here. Now we are already slip rings. And all these rotor conductors we are connected to slip rings through the brushes. Now here, these slip rings are connected to the external resistance. The use of the external resistance is to control the speed of the three-phase induction motor, which is specially designed for the slip ring induction motors. Now you can see this. All these three conductors are connected to the slip rings through the brushes, and the outer end, there's one end of this particularly slip rings, I'm connected to the this external resistance. You can call it a rheostat, or simply you can call it any high resistance. By using, you can see this structure of this external resistance, and by using the external resistance, you can control the speed of the slip ring induction motors. Now you can see the working. Now the rotor is rotating, we have connected all these parts. You can see this. Now this is R phase, this is Y phase, B phase. I am connected to the slip rings R, Y and B. Now again, this R phase I am connected to the, this is nothing but a resistance. This Y phase connected to resistance, B phase connected to resistance. I call this is nothing but an external resistance here. Now you can see this. Now rotor is rotating, and now here all these structures are connected to the resistance through the this particular slip ring and brush arrangement. And I stated earlier, by using the external resistances, now the speed of the slip ring induction motor can be easily controlled. We can see this structure in the practical sessions. Now we'll see the difference between squirrel cage induction motor and slip ring induction motor. So I made one chart regarding the difference. So first part is, rotor is in the form of bars, while in the slip ring induction motor, rotor is in the form of three phase winding. Now you can see this image. Now there is no any winding. Simple, you call it, there is no any winding. So winding is present, winding is absent, you may also call. Here you can see, now there is only rotor bars are there in the squirrel cage induction motor. Why? In the slip ring induction motor, we have the three phase winding in it. Next, second part, no slip rings and brushes are present in squirrel cage induction motor, while slip rings and brushes are present. Now again, there is no any windings, so there is no any question of slip ring and brushes. But here we can show here, this one, these are the slip ring, these are the brushes, slip ring and brushes are present. Next, third part, external resistance cannot be connected, while in slip ring induction motor, external resistance can be connected. We already seen in the previous videos, so we can connect the external resistance to the slip rings through to the induction motor through the slip rings. That means now these resistances, external resistance, we can connect to the slip rings here. Now by using this external resistance, we can easily control the speed of that particular motors. Next one, lower starting torque for squirrel cage, for slip ring it of higher starting torque, as we seen in the construction part. Now this squirrel cage rotor has a lower starting torque compared to the slip ring induction motors, or simply called as slip ring induction motor has a higher starting torque compared to the squirrel cage induction motors. Now next, it's a simple in construction, it's a complicated one. Now simple in construction, this squirrel cage motor having simple construction because there is no any winding in the rotor circuit, as well as if there is no any winding, so there is no any question of slip ring and brushes. So compared to the slip ring induction motor, the squirrel cage induction motor has a simple construction, and because of this structure, there is a winding in the rotor circuit, as well as the slip ring brush arrangement and external resistance arrangement, the design or the design or simple called as construction is little bit complicated of the slip ring induction motor compared to the squirrel cage induction motor. Next, it's a high efficiency. The particularly this, that is nothing but a squirrel cage induction motor is compared to high efficiency with respect to the slip ring induction motor, or simply we called as the squirrel cage induction motor has high efficiency, which has again the slip ring has low efficiency. Again, due to absence of the rotor winding, this squirrel cage induction motor has cheap, we call it a less cost, but due to the this rotor winding, additional winding, we call it a rotor winding, the cost of slip ring induction motor is more. Now due to absence of slip ring and brushes, it has a less maintenance, but due to presence of this slip ring and brushes, there is compared to more maintenance, there is more maintenance compared to the squirrel cage induction motors. Now again, in the squirrel cage induction motor, there is no any winding in the rotor, so its size, that is the overall size, is having smaller size compared to the slip ring induction motor. Why? Due to the extra winding in the rotor circuit, this particularly slip ring induction motor has a larger size. Now application. Now these squirrel cage induction motors are used where the low starting torque as well as the constant speed applications are required. That means the low starting torques where we use in the lathe machines, as well as centrifugal fans, or simply called flour mills, or any agriculture pumps, where we require only the low starting torque and constant speed. Why? This slip ring induction motor basically used where the high starting torques are required. That means in lift, crane, or in conveyor belt, where high settings are required, in that particular case we use only the slip ring induction motor. So this is a difference between the squirrel cage induction motor as well as slip ring induction motor. The exam, in the exam they may ask this difference for 8 marks or maybe for 4 marks as per the university pattern. So this I will list out some simplest points regarding the difference between the squirrel cage and slip ring induction motors.